through the sides of the waist. Press into your right hand and then bend your left knee and reach back for your left foot. Good. Bring the heel towards the butt. Extend the shoulder back. Breathe into the side of the waist. So I'm just going to actually show you with a strap, just because some of us that want to move deeper will really need a little bit of support from the strap, and that's perfectly good. Strap, which is really easy to use because it's already shaped, ready for your foot. But if you don't have this, you can use a regular strap and just tie a knot at the bottom. So from here, you'll take your strap around your foot, and then you'll take the other half of your strap into your hand. From here, you pull back with your elbow. And over time, maybe it feels more comfortable to gently bring the foot closer and closer. This is going to take a huge amount of flexibility, not only in your hamstring and your back, but your shoulder and your belly and your hip flexor. Over time, you'll walk the hand closer and closer, and maybe as Letty can hear, eventually you'll grab the foot. This won't take a long time. This is a really advanced asana, so don't try to become too attached with how long that's going to take. Now, eventually, once you feel stable, you might lift the second arm and also challenge your balance. Good, perfect. And then when you're ready, release. Try not to release with a ping, just release legs one at a time. And just to reset, release the back leg and fold yourself forwards. Lengthen the skin of your belly and lengthen the arms. Release. Try not to release with a ping, just release legs one at a time. Just to reset, release the back leg and fold yourself forwards. Lengthen the skin of your belly and lengthen the arms. Good, press into the palms. Tuck your left toes, come to downward facing dog. And then when you're ready, take the left leg forwards into pigeon. The sides feel particularly different when accessing these kind of postures, because it's not only the difference between just one muscle, this is the difference between a whole heap of corresponding muscles that need to work together to integrate in order to get into an asana posture. So you can see a considerable difference sometimes between sides, so don't be alarmed. You can bend your right knee. First, just bring it in, take hold of it with the right foot, strap around your foot. Soften through your mouth, soften through the jaw, but take hold. The elbow comes forwards, 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 and then maybe reaches up. And then over time, maybe you want to walk the hand in and maybe grabs the foot. And then maybe release the hands, come down into sleeping swan or pigeon. So you can, you know, try all of these exercises. These exercises are really to help us find that integration of the entirety of the body, but also to help us use our flexibility and our strength simultaneously to work towards one goal. But don't just expect to go through them once and maybe be able to get straight into the goalpost that we're working towards. Then it can take not only repeating these videos and other exercises, you know, for a really long time. Try not to get too attached to them, that, you know, because that's how we create disappointment within our practice, that we create these goals that are not always achievable, at least immediately or in the short term. It's kind of a really good way of sucking the joy out of your practice. So instead, just trying to enjoy them and try to enjoy the entirety of the journey rather than just the destination. I know that's a really typical yoga thing to say, but it's true, unfortunately. Press into your hands, come to downward facing dog. And you can always come back to those twists that we did before just to alleviate any tension or compression that may have occurred. So eventually we want to be back bending, not really from the flexibility of the back, but by using the support network of the strength of our hamstrings and our glutes and our back muscles, flexibility of the hip flexors, the belly and the shoulders. So it's like we backbend from using the front plane of the body. So you're working towards no compression in the lower back, but I know that you say that, but I myself have experienced compression because I continuously back bended. So I know that it does happen. So if that does happen, just as long as you stretch it out at the end and work towards a practice that doesn't have that. And then come onto your knees, take the shins to the side and come down onto your back. And then lengthen your legs forwards.